Hello guys, I welcome all of you to today's Farmcast, and today also we'll be discussing 5 drug of choice, one anti cancer drug, and a couple of questions asked by students, right? And one question is, I'm not able to retain much even after repeating revisions many times, what to do? And second question is, how to take breaks during preparation? So these are two questions which I've chosen from those which you have asked. So I'll discuss this at last. And today guys, let us begin with the drug of choice. And today, frankly speaking, the disorder I'm about to discuss, right, usually you know I discuss 5 drugs of choice, but today I'll discuss only one disorder. But that one disorder has many subtypes which will even be more than 5 drugs of choice which we usually discuss. So guys, the disorder for today is epilepsy and seizure, right? So epilepsy and seizure, you know, there are various subtypes, and that is why we'll discuss today only epilepsy. And guys, let us begin with generalized epilepsy. So generalized epilepsy, guys, if they ask you GTCS, generalized tonic-clonic seizure, or grand mal epilepsy, or myoclonic seizure, the most common subtype of which is JME, or juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, what is the drug of choice? I guess, guys, all of you must know this answer, and that is valproate, isn't it? Valproate is the most preferred drug for GTCS, myoclonic seizure, that is JME. Whereas absence seizure is a bit controversial, right? But after going through a lot of resources, guys, I've tried to solve this mystery. Now, absence seizure, remember, if it is a case of typical absence seizure, then in your exams, you go for ethosuximide. The ethosuximide is not widely available in India, but still most of the guidelines that I went through, guys, they bet for ethosuximide for typical absence seizure. So typical absence seizure, ethosuximide. If it is atypical absence seizure, it does not respond to ethosuximide. So there we can go for valproate. So that is, guys, the mystery of absence seizure. Stick to this in your exams. Now moving on to the second disorder for today, that is partial seizure, right? Second type of seizure or epilepsy. Partial seizure, guys, drug of choice is carbamazepine, and carbamazepine has been the universal drug of choice for a lot of time. But nowadays we have latest drugs like lamotrigine, etc., which are also used, like oxcarbazepine. But nevertheless, carbamazepine is still the universal drug of choice in partial seizure. If it is not in the option, then you can go for drugs like lamotrigine or oxcarbazepine. Moving on to the third disorder for today, guys, if it is a case of mixed seizure syndrome, see, mixed seizure syndrome like Lennox-Gastaut syndrome or Dravet syndrome, the worst part about mixed seizure syndrome is that these seizures, they are usually not responsive to most of the sodium channel blockers like phenytoin, carbamazepine, right? So these drugs, they do not act here. So here we choose a drug in mixed seizure syndrome which has a wide spectrum of mechanism of action. That is, it is a calcium channel blocker, it is a sodium channel blocker, it acts via GABA. And does it ring a bell, guys? Which drug am I talking here about? Guys, here I'm talking about valproate. So remember, Lennox-Gastaut syndrome, Dravet syndrome, these are mixed seizure syndrome for which valproate is the drug of choice. Now moving on to the fourth one for today, that is infantile spasm. Guys, infantile spasm, the drug of choice actually depends upon association of tuberous sclerosis. So if it is infantile spasm with tuberous sclerosis, your answer would be vigabatrin. Whereas if it is a case without tuberous sclerosis, then go for ACTH, right? ACTH, it is less toxic as compared to vigabatrin. Then why we do not use it in case of tuberous sclerosis? Because ACTH is not effective if there are organic lesions in the brain like tubers in case of tuberous sclerosis. Number 5, there is a syndrome called as West syndrome. And West syndrome is nothing, guys, it is infantile spasm associated with mental retardation, and here also ACTH is the drug of choice. Number 6, seizures in neonates. Guys, remember, seizures in neonates, the most common cause is hypoxia, HIE, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy to the brain, right? And phenobarbital is the drug of choice. Why phenobarbital is the drug of choice? The reason being, guys, barbiturates, they decrease the cerebral metabolic rate and they decrease oxygen consumption. So this is an extra effect apart from anti-epileptic effect, which is desirable in case of HIE, right? Now let's talk about epilepsy in pregnancy. So guys, epilepsy in pregnancy, the current drug of choice is levetiracetam. Right, it has changed. The current drug of choice is levetiracetam. Two other drugs which are preferred in epilepsy in pregnancy are lamotrigine and clonazepam. So three drugs: levetiracetam, lamotrigine, clonazepam. The preferred one is levetiracetam. And finally, the last one for today, guys, status epilepticus. All of you know this is an easy one. Lorazepam is the drug of choice for status epilepticus. Now, guys, we have come to the second part, that is anti-cancer drugs. So for today, I'll be discussing two pyrimidine analogs, 5-fluorouracil capecitabine. These are the most commonly asked pyrimidine analogs. And 5-fluorouracil is an intravenous drug. Capecitabine is an oral prodrug of 5-fluorouracil. So both these drugs are essentially same. The only difference is route of administration. One is IV, one is oral. And both these drugs, guys, how they act? They act by inhibiting thymidinate synthase, and thus they inhibit DNA synthesis, so they block S phase. Now, use of both these drugs, they can be used for treatment of lower GIT cancer. I've told you many times before in the PharmCast as well, lower GIT cancer, that is colorectal cancer as well as anal cancer. These two are the drug of choice. Side effect, it has been asked a couple of times. Both these drugs, they can cause hand and foot syndrome. So what happens in hand and foot syndrome? There is desquamation of the palms and soles, and they are bright red in color. And it's a very painful condition, guys. And if I talk about capecitabine and 5-fluorouracil, capecitabine is a more common cause of hand and foot syndrome as compared to 5-fluorouracil. So that's all for today, guys, in the section of drugs that I had to discuss. Now we have come to our last section where I discuss few questions that you keep on asking me every day, and I come up with some solution, right? The first question, guys, for today is, I'm unable to retain much after repeated revisions. So the student was asking me, even after I've revised many times, still I'm not able to retain those information. So sir, do you have any solution for me? See, guys, a simple solution for this is you have to revise while revising, right? So let me break it down for you. It might sound confusing. What does it mean by revise while revising, guys? There is a pattern of revision called as sequential revision. And what happens in sequential revision? This is a method, a study method that I used to follow for volatile subjects like biochemistry, microbiology, pharmacology. You know that, guys. We study so many times and we still forget it. I still begin to sweat when I look at that Krebs cycle, guys, in biochemistry, right? I still cannot get over it. So what we do in this sequential revision pattern, see, guys, it's very simple. Whatever I revise today, right? Whatever I revise today, suppose I've divided my revision into two halves, right? 5 hours one subject, 5 hours another subject, for example. So whatever I revise today for 5 hours, tomorrow what I'll do, I will specially dedicate 20 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes to revise again whatever I have studied today. And day after tomorrow, guys, I'll again revise the same thing for 5 minutes. So every day you will study something and you'll revise something which you have studied yesterday and day before yesterday. So let it run in triplets, right? Triplets. And you can revise in 5 minutes. Why? See, because I have studied it yesterday for 15 to 20 minutes. I've studied it day before yesterday for around 4 to 5 hours. So now I'm third time revising, which means what? I just need to overlook whatever I have revised. So guys, you might think, what, this 5 minute will make a difference? Guys, it makes a hell lot of difference. Even 5 minutes of overlooking on the third day, right? So you know, in physiology, right, how do you generate the permanent memory? How do you generate it? By repetition. So what I'm doing here is I'm repeating again, time and again. So this is how, guys, what I did is for these volatile subjects, to retain them for a longer period of time, because you know, in pharma, biochemistry, micro, there are a lot of facts, guys, and it takes a toll. So if you follow this, guys, I guarantee you, your retention will become rock solid. All right. So this is your first question and a solution to that. Now moving on to the second question, how to take breaks during revision. Now, this is a general question, guys, and you know, every person is different from another. So everyone has a way of taking breaks during revision. So I'll tell you, I mean, I cannot say, I don't know how girls, they take a break, right? But I'm a guy and I can tell you what we used to do for our breaks. And for most of my co-aspirants, right, they used to have fag breaks, and I was not a smoker then, so I wasn't interested in those fag breaks. But I had my own way of taking a break. So I'll tell you what I used to do to take a break. So I'll take a break, but still I'm not wasting the time, right? I'm still actively doing something at the same time relaxing myself. So what I used to do is I used to take a cup of coffee after 4 hours of study. I'm tired, right? My back is hurting, I'm having headache or something like that. So I need to relax my back as well as I need to relax my mind. So what I used to do after 4 hours of study, I used to have a cup of coffee, and after that coffee I'll lie down for 15 to 20 minutes, right? Close my eyes, and I try to recall whatever I had studied for the last 4 hours. So what happens is you are relaxing at the same time, you're relaxing your back, you're relaxing your mind, because you are not actively studying something, but passively you are trying to, you know, memorize whatever you have studied in the past 4 hours. So you are at the same time, you're relaxing as well as you are, you know, utilizing the time to remember whatever you have studied. So that is how I used to relax, guys. And see, taking this coffee is important, because once I lie down, and I ran out of coffee, I was not having coffee, so I didn't have time, so I thought I'll just relax like that, and I lied down, and then I woke up after 2 hours. So I wasted a lot of time. Then I realized that coffee is an important part of this process of relaxation. So guys, the problems that we have, they are complex, right? Many a times in our life you will see that the complex problems in our life, they have simple solutions, right? We need to just look around us, and we need to strategize, right? We need to strategize. And many of you might think, right, while you are preparing, right, I have seen students, they tend to get depressed that I have studied from a peripheral college, or I had not studied well during my undergraduate days, and that is why I do not stand a chance. Guys, you are wrong. There is nothing like that. A competitive exam is altogether a different ball game, right? Even if you take my case, I used to study, you know, quite religiously while I was in my first year and second year, because, you know, initially you have that stamina and you have that goal, but after 2 years what happens is the extracurricular activities, they start, and you tend to lose your, you know, focus. And then after 2 years, so first 2 years I was the topper, but after 2 years I was the topper, but from down. So why? Because what used to happen is I started not to study continuously. I would just study just before the exams, so just to get through the exam. So that happens to many of us. So it happened like that. Time passed, and then when I came to internship and I started preparing, then I had to strategize, because I knew my areas of weakness, where I was weak. So guys, the first thing you need to do is find your areas of weakness, where you are weak at, which subjects you are weak at, and make a strategy and work hard and target. And believe me, you can beat the bestest of the best person just by making a good strategy and religiously following it, guys. Right? So there is nothing like that you are from periphery medical college, or you didn't have a good stint while you're in your undergraduate, so you cannot score well in these competitive exams. It's a myth. There is nothing like that. Work hard, and you can get any seat of your choice, any rank of your choice. You can get it, guys. I'm guaranteeing you. But you should have that guts to believe in yourself. Yes, you need guts to believe in yourself that I can do this, right? So believe in yourself, guys. Stop giving yourself excuses. These are your defense mechanisms, right? So stop fooling yourself. You're fooling nobody else. You're fooling yourself, right? So get this out of your head and put the medal on the pedal and keep racing, guys. So that's all for today, guys. And if you have any doubts like these in your preparations, guys, you can always let me know in the comment box. I'll try to incorporate your doubts in one of my next farmcasts, guys. So that's all for today, guys. Lots of love. Take care. Bye-bye. This is Dr. Ranjan with you.